The more modern philosophical and political theory that I read and watch and am exposed to, the more I sort of find this, everyone's sort of pointing at the same thing about capitalism as it exists post the 70s, neoliberal capitalism, capitalist realism, postmodern condition, whatever, or even before that. But people are, everyone from everyone's sort of trying to, everyone's sort of getting at the same point, which is, it used to be that capitalists could say, well, capitalism is just a really good system. You know, the way it works, things, there's growth, there's economic growth. You know, you're probably going to be better off than your parents, and your children are probably going to be better off than you. But now that's demonstrably not true anymore. And no one believes this. In fact, it's very common knowledge that lots of things in the capitalism doesn't don't work. Lots of things in state capitalism are just a, they don't work as they're intended to. It's so common knowledge to say that politicians lie and are corrupt and, you know, really out for themselves and their powerful friends, that it's passé. If you the you could talk to anyone. No one trusts politicians. No one. Who trusts politicians? In surveys, their distrust for politicians is always high. You know, The Simpsons can parody it. Everyone knows that political institutions are corrupt, and giant corporations like Facebook and Tesla and whatever are, you know, running on like a system of authoritarian power. They trying to grab as much power as possible. Everyone knows these things, and yet, so the argument that, like, oh, capitalism's just the it's just great, it just works the best, it falls apart. No one actually believes it anymore. You know, we know that our governments are spying. It's like Zizek said, like Zizek points out, like, ideology works even if you don't believe in it. In the same way, we all know that the American two-party system, for example, is completely ineffectual, and representative democracy in such a restricted way is just nothing. It's just nothing. It's just, that doesn't work in the interest of almost anyone. And yet, every time the election rolls by, everyone fucking talks about it as if it's the most important shit to ever happen. Because even though they know it's not true, the ideology still works. And it seems like, so capitalism has sort of shifted its goal from being like, well, or its rhetoric, let's say propaganda, whatever, from being like, oh, it's just the best system. It, like, it just it's so great. Why would you not like it? To, well, look, everyone knows it doesn't work that well, but there is no alternative. That's what it's basically been reduced to, is like, well, what are you gonna do? What are you gonna do about it? There is no alternative. It's capitalist realism. And everyone has sort of been pointing to the same fact. You go from Stirner to fucking the Situationists to Baudrillard to Mark Fisher and beyond. Everyone's pointing at this same idea that the capitalism has sort of created this fake world, or depending on who you ask, it's spooks, it's a spectacle, it's simulacra, it's, you know, whatever. That there's this, like, fake world that we're sort of forced to live in, and we sort of know it's not real, but we can't really tell what's real and what's not real, and everything's really confusing, and that's in by design. And it's this world where there's no alternative to the state of things. And that's how the world sustains itself. It's a war, as David Graeber said, it's a war against the human imagination. Because if people are allowed to think of alternatives, if people are allowed to believe in alternatives to the world as it is, and I'm not saying fucking communism or whatever, you know, I'm not saying, oh, alternatives, just like Mao said, you know, like No. Think, talk, discuss, innovate, create. People are allowed to do that freely. Well, then the last tenuous grasp of neoliberalism of, well, it sucks, but there's no alternative. It fails because then someone can think, people can think of alternatives. People can imagine a future significantly different from our own, right? And so every coercive power in the fucking universe is running a war against the human imagination. And to even be imaginative significantly is like, it's very dangerous. It's not a good idea. It's never a good idea. So, you can, or that's not even necessarily true. To be materially imaginative, to actually create, is discouraged. And I'm not saying like vaguely, I'm saying materially. If you make art, for example, well, good luck making art while also working a job in order to pay your rent. And if you want to make art that makes money, good luck doing it with anything other than just reproducing what's already popular or reproducing a genre you've already heard, because that's what people are going to buy. Good luck doing it without support from a label or a company like Spotify. Imagine your music gets taken off Spotify and Apple and Google and all that shit. How are you going to make money? So don't say any, don't do anything that wouldn't be allowed there, like copyright infringement, for example. Don't make any plunderphonics music, or don't make it any documentaries with footage that you haven't paid for. Because if it gets taken off those platforms, then it's not allowed to exist. Only this very specific form of creativity is allowed to exist, and it's a material thing. And the thing is, people know they're doing it, and they can't help they and they know that knowing they're doing it is not a solution. Ideology works even when you know it's happening. It's like the placebo effect. So like when you sit down with your guitar or whatever and you play a punk song, you know you're making a punk song. You know you're not innovating. When you make a drawing, you're thinking of all the styles of people that are similar to you. And you, when you make a YouTube video, you're thinking like, what can I do that will actually, how can I clickbait this thumbnail, how can I make it so people actually click on my shit? But you can see it right now happening with all the Among Us stuff on YouTube. It's like a fran it's actually kind of it's like something out of a horror movie. The sort of frantic scramble of these thumbnails and titles as they as the market becomes increasingly saturated, and they sort of, it's like they're all trapped in a bucket trying to escape stepping on each other, trying to out extreme thumbnail. It's desperate. It feels desperate. 9,000 billion IQ play the fuck the bitch in Among Us. I stole everyone's car in Among Us. And then like the colors in the thumbnails, they get brighter and more saturated. It's until eventually it's just gonna become like noise or whatever, or and everyone's, because the market becomes slowly more saturated. There's more and more Among Us videos. And at the same time, people are losing interest in Among Us because, there's only so much, because that's how capitalism works. That's how culture is designed to work. Not even capitalism, that's how culture is designed to work. That when there's something popular, everyone jumps on it. Everyone chases the ball and beats it into the ground as fast as possible and kills themselves because now it doesn't work anymore. And then everyone freaks out and goes back to not knowing what to do. And hopefully, maybe a couple of people succeeded off of that, Disguised Toast gains a couple million subscribers, XQC gains a couple million followers or whatever, and then everyone else is left in the dirt. That's how culture works, because you're materially discouraged from doing anything else. Oh, well, you want to make you want to make Among Us videos that aren't like that. You want to make other, you want to play it like an art game or something. You want to do an art game let's play. You want to play a game from, you want to play Deus Ex or something, I don't know. An old game that people don't care about anymore. Well, good luck making money off of that. Oh, you don't care about making money off of that? Well, then you have to have a job. So good luck having time to edit all the videos. Good luck having time to just sit and be creative. You're spending most of your time at work. Good luck having the energy to make a good playthrough that you're happy with and edit it and etc. Good luck having the money to buy the equipment to even do it. You're materially discouraged from doing anything like that. And this is kind of the point of Denpomorp. This is kind of why I consider Denpomorp to be like literally anarchist activism. Because we consider activism to be this like very specific thing, like, oh, you organize with your fellow leftists or whatever, and your fellow Marxists, and you have a meeting, you discuss the social programs you're gonna do. Oh, we're gonna go around and we're gonna give food to people, and then we're gonna go protest. Yeah, like that's it. I mean, it's possible. It's capable of making some performative change. It's possible of making some change. There are anarchist organizations which feed the homeless, and you know the police try and shut them down, and they keep doing it. They keep feeding the homeless, and that's someone who wouldn't have had food otherwise. They work for certain situations, but they're not revolutionary, you know. They don't change society. They're more about trying to survive in the shitty world that we've built for ourselves. So the point, in some sense, of what Denpomorp's about is creating this space where, you know, when Ethernet sits down and she makes a song, there's no thought about what's gonna make money or what's popular or who's gonna listen to it. My friends are gonna listen to it, and I'm gonna be have fun making it, and that's what matters. And then I can actually create something innovative. When one of us decides to make a YouTube video, you know, I'm not trying to make money. You're not trying to make money. We're not. I don't care. I'll say whatever I need to say. You know, there's no like, oh. It's sort of like YouTube, you know? The world is sort of like YouTube. YouTube is a great little miniature snow globe of the world. Everyone on YouTube hates YouTube. All YouTubers, they hate it. They hate the site, they hate the people who run it, they hate everything about it. And you know, because they won't shut up about how terrible it is. They won't shut up about how all their videos get demonetized, and they won't shut up about how they get copyright claims, and how they're not being paid enough, and how YouTube is never communicating with them. They won't shut up about it. And those videos that they make get millions of views on YouTube. And yet, no one can do anything about it because there is no alternative. There is no other website that fulfills the same purpose as YouTube. And even if there is, but there is other websites. They exist. Like PeerTube, for example, PeerTube, or DTube, or you know, not hosting your shit on a streaming platform, but having it, you know, for example, just on your own website, or having a torrent link somewhere on your own website, or so, you know, there is alternative. You only have to think about it for a second to realize there's alternatives. BitChute, you know, or there's a million alternatives. And but I'm sure every single one of those I just said, you can think of some reason, like, oh well, you know, it wouldn't work because this, it, or oh well, YouTube has a monopoly. Well, it's really ideology that keeps people on YouTube. It's really a matter of the fact that everyone believes that if, oh well, if I, you know, I could move to PeerTube, but you know, then I would just be throwing away all of my audience or something like that, you know. It would take everyone to operate together. We need organization. Is that true though? Like, is that true? This is why. What if you do what I do? Just fill up YouTube servers with hours and hours of useless content that only a few people, 100 people, are gonna care about, without any intention to make money off of YouTube, with ad block on, with sponsor block on, with VPNs and anti-browser fingerprinting and cookie destruction. It's like being a hikikomori, you know? It's like dropping out of society and not letting them take a control of your mind, not letting them limit your creativity. If you don't care about money, you can do anything. But everyone needs to care about money. That's kind of what Denpa Mob is it's a support network. It's like a mutual aid network. It's like a mutual aid by way of the Union of Egoists, where everyone's out for themselves. Everyone's doing it because it benefits them. Everyone, no one's forced into Denpa Mob, you know? Everyone likes it, and everyone helps each other out. And that's just how it is, because, you know, we all, that's how mutual aid works. We're all kind of friends. We're all friends. I know, we're all friends. There we go. That's a good way of putting it. Instead of using all these fucking philosophical terms, I just say we're all friends. It's a space for actual creativity to happen and actual innovation to happen. And not all of it's good. I've made some bad videos, I've made some bad music. That doesn't matter, that's the point. Not all of it has to work. The only situation where all of it has to work is if in capitalism, where it can't be allowed to not work, because then you're not making money. But if you only care about creativity, then you're allowed to fail, and there's no negative consequences. And not only that, but we can build alternative economic models and support models and stuff just by ourselves. We can figure out ways, you know, obviously the most obvious thing is Patreon and merch sales and whatever to support ourselves. But most of us are like neets, living somehow, autism bucks, neet bucks, with our parents, whatever, making supplementary income, but not enough to survive on. With what we actually care about, which is fine. They say, oh, you love your job, you never work a moment in your day, but, I mean, you'll never work a day in your life. But that's actually, like, a weird dynamic. Because then, if you make your hobby into your job, then it's very hard to figure out what's what. You're never really not at work. You're never really not doing labor. And that's very difficult on mental health for a lot of people. So if you make nothing your job and everything your hobby, it's the opposite. You never have to figure that out. You never have to even worry about it. You know, there's no rush. There's no franticness. There's none of the Among Us thumbnail escalation. There's none of that. There's none of that because it doesn't matter. It's an alternative, it's a viable alternative, right there in front of you. And, you know, sustainability doesn't have to play into it. Nothing else has to play into it other than it's happening, it exists, it's right there, you can see it, you can be there, you can touch it, you could talk to it. It's really better than most forms of activism. it's better than, like, protesting on the streets. It's actually... Because what are you going to protest? You protest on the streets, it's more like begging the government, or begging a corporation, or begging some power structure to do something for you. It's better to just flat out refuse to do anything for them. That's my opinion anyway. I feel like there's something else I was going to say as well, but I don't remember what it was. That works.